Hello, this is the first in my series of looking at different phases of the menstrual cycle in a bit more detail. Today we're going to be looking at the luteal phase of the menstrual cycle, and this is part of my series of videos looking at the separate phases of the menstrual cycle. I have already made a video giving an overview of all the phases of the menstrual cycle and the way I see them, so please look at that if you haven't already. You might think it's a bit odd that I'm looking at the luteal phase. The luteal phase is the second half of the cycle. So on a 28-day cycle, which is an average, and I'm fully aware that not every woman is average. Well, who is average? Who has an exactly 28-day cycle all of the time? But it's from ovulation, which is around day 14 on this average 28-day cycle. And the whole of the luteal phase actually, scientifically, it's said to last until the first day of menstruation. What I want to share with you is that there are two distinct parts to this luteal phase. The first part's the first week or so, and the second part is the last few days. I also want to share with you something that you maybe aren't aware of, and I feel isn't emphasised enough when people talk about the early part of the luteal phase. So that's from day 15 for about a week, so day 22, 23. In this phase, our body actually does exactly the same thing whether the egg that we ovulated at ovulation, halfway through the cycle, was fertilised or not. This might surprise you. So essentially, it's the first week of pregnancy. I'm going to explain why this is the case. You might think this is a bit strange, but don't worry, we'll come to this. So we're looking at essentially the first week after ovulation, when our body is essentially preparing to receive a fertilised egg in our womb and to help this fertilised egg implant. But our body does exactly the same whether the egg is fertilised or not, because it needs to get ready. So I like to think of this phase as we're making a nest within our womb for the egg to implant. So this is why I call this phase the nurturing part of the cycle. It is the time of our cycle when the lining of the womb continues to build because it's preparing to receive a fertilised egg. Whether the egg is fertilised or not, it still does the same. And so I have an affirmation for this phase, which is, I create a safe space to support my creation. That's essentially the potential of this phase. We're creating a safe space whether the egg arrives or not. We're building up our energies to support it. It's a bit like creating a nest within our body. And the other part of this nourishing side is I create a nourishing relationship with myself so that I can create nourishing relationships with others. So again, the other might be the fertilized egg and a pregnancy, but it can just be an energy of how we mother ourselves and how we can be mothering and loving and nourishing towards others. The challenge, each phase of our menstrual cycle has its gifts. So the gift of this phase is creating a nourishing space. The challenge is, can I allow my energies to withdraw inwards and slow down? It is an inner drawing in phase. It's a gathering in and a slowing down, potentially. And it could be that we resist this slowing down and drawing in. So I want to explain a bit more, first of all, physiologically, what's going on in our body. Because sometimes it's just presented as, well, there's ovulation, the egg isn't fertilised, and then our body's just preparing for menstruation. But that is not the case. If we ovulate, our body prepares first for pregnancy. And then if the egg doesn't arrive in the womb, it's only then that our body does something different, which, if the egg isn't fertilised, is preparing for menstruation. So energetically as well, sometimes people talk about the seasons, and this is autumn drawing in. It's not as simple as that. I was covered that briefly in my previous videos, but we're going to look at that a little bit more. Sometimes those of you who study Chinese medicine, this phase is sometimes talked about as the yang phase of the cycle, but again, it's a bit more complex than that. So let's start with what is actually happening. So we've had ovulation. The egg has been released from the follicle. So the follicle is a fluid-filled sac within the ovary that contains an egg. And during the cycle, about 5 to 10 immature eggs in their follicles are being prepared. But as we know, only one fully matures. Well, it's not fully mature, because full maturation happens when it meets a sperm, but it's the next stage of its maturation. And this more mature egg is released through ovulation. Now, if it's fertilized, it's going to carry on a journey down the fallopian tube and eventually, hopefully, arriving in the womb. If it's not fertilized, it dies within about 24-36 hours. So yes, there are two different things that happen to the egg. It's either fertilized or not. It either lives or dies. But regardless of that, a woman's body does the same thing. Now, why is it doing the same thing, and what is the thing that it's doing? Well, basically, the follicle, the fluid-filled sac within the ovary that released the egg, transforms into a new structure, which is actually called the corpus luteum. So I think quite a lot of people have heard of this name, the corpus luteum, but don't really quite know what it is. So I am going to take a moment to explain to you what it is. Corpus luteum basically means the yellow body, and it's coloured yellow because it takes cholesterol from the blood stream within it. And it actually grows. This follicle continues to grow for about a week to 10 days. And you can see this on the charts that I showed, and I will put up a picture of the chart. The follicle, which is a yellow body, becomes now called the corpus luteum, the yellow body, and it grows. And it grows for about a week to 10 days. And it's getting bigger. The ovaries become bigger because the follicle is growing bigger. And it does this whether the egg is fertilized or not. Sorry to keep going on about this, but I think it's something that people don't really understand. And what is it doing? Well, it's actually staying within the ovary, and it's acting as a temporary hormone producing structure, an endocrine structure. And it's producing the hormones which could support a pregnancy. So I think most of you, if you know the hormones in the menstrual cycle, you know that after ovulation, progesterone, which was low in the early part of the cycle, increases quite considerably. So the levels of progesterone rise a lot. And this is because the corpus luteum is producing, it's receiving signals from the brain, and it's producing progesterone. It's increasing the levels of progesterone a lot. What is the effect of progesterone? Progesterone prepares the body for pregnancy. It raises our temperature slightly. It's thought that raising the temperature helps an egg to incubate. a fertilised egg to incubate. But our body does this whether the egg is fertilised or not. Our temperature rises a bit, and the progesterone also helps the lining of the womb to continue to build. It helps the lining to thicken to about 7 to 9 millimetres, which is the thickest it's going to be. So the lining of the womb grows more, it thickens more after ovulation. This is part of making the nest. It has the glands within the womb become more curled. There's nourishing fluids that are being secreted. It's already getting ready for potentially for a fertilized egg to arrive and to implant. Also, progesterone is quite a calming hormone. It helps us to become more relaxed, more inwards. Progesterone also stops the womb from contracting. So you're not going to have it, it's suppressing contractions of the womb. That's going to be quite important for pregnancy, although the womb does contract, but it contracts at a low level of intensity. So progesterone just helps the womb be a calmer place as well. Progesterone also brings about changes in our breast tissue, again preparing for pregnancy. So often there can be a bit of fullness, sensitivity in the breast. So it's quite an inner hormone. If we were to say yin or yang, it's a bit more inwards. And sometimes people say, oh, it's progesterone. Well, it is the dominant hormone of this phase of the menstrual cycle for a week while the corpus luteum is producing it. But actually, sometimes people overlook the fact that estrogen levels are also quite high. They're a bit lower than they were for ovulation. I think a lot of you know that estrogen has a rise to help with ovulation, along with follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone. But actually, it still remains higher in this phase of the cycle, the luteal phase, than it was in most of the previous phase, the follicular phase. People sometimes forget that. So estrogen is also quite high. Estrogen is also being produced by the corpus luteum, along with another important hormone of pregnancy, relaxin. So the corpus luteum acts as a temporary hormonal structure, creating progesterone, estrogen, and relaxin. And it does this for about a week to 10 days, if the egg is not fertilized. So basically, after about a week or 10 days, it needs another signal to tell it to carry on producing and indeed even increasing progesterone, estrogen, and relaxin, which are three key hormones for pregnancy. Relaxin is a hormone that actually, it's a bit like its name says, it softens tissue, it's preparing for implantation. If a fertilized egg does arrive in the womb, and it takes a fertilized egg about a week to 10 days to arrive in the womb, and it may arrive in the womb, and to implant. So that to start with, the fertilized egg spirals down the fallopian tube, it arrives in the bigger space of the womb, and then it looks for somewhere to implant. It needs a nice, thick, juicy, nourishing environment, a nest to implant. And when, as soon as it implants, it actually, it's the outer part of the egg, the trophoblast, which will eventually contribute to creating the placenta, and it's the placenta which will eventually produce the progesterone, the relaxin, and the estrogen during pregnancy. But at this stage, it's just some cells which make a connection with the wall of the womb. And as they do this, another hormone, HCG, human chorionic gonadotropin, is produced. And this sends a signal back through the blood to the corpus luteum to carry on. So if a fertilized egg arrives in the womb, the corpus luteum gets a signal from the implanting egg to continue. And the corpus luteum, if we're pregnant, actually continues to grow and get bigger. And it continues, in fact, for about 10 weeks. Quite a long time. So the corpus luteum can get quite big. And why does it eventually disintegrate after about 10 weeks? It's because the placenta has taken over this production. So it takes that time for the placenta to grow and develop. That's a whole other subject, what happens in pregnancy. But coming back to, if the egg is not fertilized, the corpus luteum only has a life of about 7 to 10 days. If it doesn't receive this signal from the womb and from the HCG. HCG, by the way, is the hormone that is measured in a pregnancy test. And that's why you can't do a pregnancy test till about at least 10 days to 2 weeks after fertilization, because you've got to wait for the egg to implant before you get the HCG levels rising. And a few more days, and then those levels go up. But if the corpus luteum doesn't receive that, then it starts to disintegrate. And it's the disintegration of the corpus luteum about 7 to 10 days after ovulation, which then triggers the hormonal changes. So the progesterone levels go down, the estrogen levels go down, the relaxin levels go down. And that stimulates the changes which lead to menstruation. That's something actually quite different. And I'm going to include those days after essentially the death of the corpus luteum. I'm going to look at those in my next video, which will be on menstruation. So coming back to this phase while the corpus luteum is growing and developing. It's about building a nest. So hopefully you've understood that a bit more. There's a couple of other things that happen during this phase. Our cervix also closes to protect eventually an egg, and our cervical fluids become stickier, and we have a plug which make it more difficult for sperm to enter the womb. So it's a protective mechanism. Our vagina becomes a bit drier, and a lot of women find around this first week after ovulation, they less want to have sex. It's a protective mechanism to give the best opportunity for a fertilised egg to implant. And so I find this phase of the menstrual cycle, this week to 10 days, can be really different for different women, which is why I don't like to say, you know, it's autumn. Or it's, in Chinese medicine, sometimes people say it's a yang phase. It's a phase where you've got, don't forget, you've got progesterone and estrogen in quite high levels. So I feel why women react very differently to this is because there is a slight tension between this more inner movement, which is progesterone predominantly, but it's the combination of progesterone and estrogen, and the more outer movement. And some women find it hard to balance the two. And so they can get a bit frustrated, especially if they have more of an outer, they stay with that energy of ovulation, they want to be expressive. Sometimes people say that's the summer phase, or it is a yang aspect. In Chinese medicine, we talk about the yang, the moving outwards, the connecting with others. There's this tension between connecting with others, but also nourishing within to prepare for the pregnancy. And essentially it is pregnancy. It's the first week of pregnancy. Also, the lining of the womb needs to keep getting thicker. And that takes some of our energy. And if our energy has not built, or if the lining, the blood, what is blood? It's an expression of our energy. If our blood hasn't built, we haven't nourished ourselves, then maybe our energy is quite low still in this phase. So even if our egg was fertilized, maybe we don't have the energy to support it. That's quite important. But it's not just about supporting the egg, it's about supporting us. So some women may, even though this is the phase when our energy is in the cycle, just before the corpus luteum starts to disintegrate, this should be the time when we feel the most vibrant. Our energy, Our physical and emotional energy is the strongest. Our womb lining is the thickest. We're at our most kind of juicy and nourishing and mothering at this phase. But not if we're actually still quite depleted. So some women feel quite depleted through the whole cycle. They may not have this tension between the inner and the outer. They may just feel quite tired. And other women might feel they've got this big surge of energy, and there's a tension between this inner movement, and so they might feel a bit frustrated. They don't know how to channel their energy, especially if we don't recognize that this phase does contain this inner movement, and we don't perhaps listen to our body and see what's the individual balance for us between slowing down and nourishing ourselves, but being open to the outer world. So it's not just simply about autumn and going inwards. It's also about how we continue to express ourselves in the outer world. As women, we can do many things at one time. I like to think of these also as phases that aren't just related to the menstrual cycle, but phases, well, I've already alluded to some of them, other phases of our life. This week gives us an opportunity to be in a more nourishing space, to think about not only how we nourish ourselves, but how we nourish others. What's the balance between this inner and outer nourishment? Yeah, so in terms of life phases, also for men, it's about how men nourish themselves. The kind of equivalent for men would be the final stages of maturation of the sperm. But for men it's different because there's always sperm in different stages of maturation. It's also how we consolidate and nurture projects or other creative activities. I quite like to look at the menstrual cycle as not only about creating babies, although that is obviously quite an important part of it, but how we create anything, how we create a project, a book perhaps, or a video, or a garden, and how we express our creative energy in all its different forms. The image also that I like to come back to, what are the gifts of this phase? It's that nourishment aspect. It's the nest. How do we make our nest? How are we in the nest? Nest building is often talked about for women at the end of pregnancy, but it's relevant for many other stages of our lives. How do we feel safe? How do we feel contained? How do we take our nourishment? Making our nest involves maybe what is our nest? It's our house. And how do we need to have a house that's basically sound, that has a good structure. In a way, you could say that's the early part of the phase. Then how, once we've got our basic structure, do we fill it up and make it ours and make it supportive? Make it a space that we feel safe, a space that we can rest, that we can grow in. Different people are going to do that in different ways, having rugs or cloths or candles. So essentially the gifts of this phase are how much we are comfortable with of a slowing down and a containing. So questions we can ask to support ourselves in this phase are actually being quite sensitive to the food that we eat, to make sure that we have really nourishing food, and that's going to be different for different people. So I feel one of the most fundamental gifts of this phase is how we move between our inner and our outer worlds, and how much we can pay attention to what supports us, and if we're tired we rest, and what actually supports us to build up our energy. It can be food, it can be rest, it could also be touch, maybe getting a massage or a shiatsu, or just touching ourselves, mothering ourselves. And also listening to what kind of movements feel good for us. And it can perhaps vary from day to day within this phase, or whether it's in the morning or the afternoon or the evening, but listening to our body. So I've got some videos on different exercises and movements that you can do that are more mothering type movements. I'm just going to finish with connecting with the earth and anchoring. So maybe take a moment to pause and connect with the space in which you find yourself, the nest where you are. How supportive and nourishing does it feel? Are you warm? Are you safe? Can you look around you and feel nourished by the objects? And if you're outside, you might want to touch the earth. But even if you're inside, perhaps feel that support of something quite yin and containing and holding. In our body, this is very much our lower limbs, our legs. So using the mothering quality of touch, like a mother holding her baby, containing and slow, and supporting a connection to the earth. And also perhaps just giving yourself a big hug, containing, wrapping your arms around you. Imagine you're being the mother
to your inner child, to your baby. Just close your eyes and hug yourself. And feel a deep, slow sense of being held and loved. So thank you for listening to me. And if you have any questions or things that you want to share about your connection to this phase, then please just put a comment down below, and I'll reply to them.